Welcome to our service this morning. We are so glad you are able to join with us today. Together, we come to worship an amazing God. Let's worship and give praise to our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. Blessed are you, O God, creator of all that is.
Blessed are you, O God, creator of all that will be.
Blessed are you, O God, who made us in your image.
Let us remember what our God has done. Praise be to God.
Please join in the opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Please join me in the opening prayer. Father in heaven, our hearts desire the warmth of your love, and our minds are searching for the light of your word. Increase our longing for Christ our Savior, and give us the strength to grow in love, that the dawn of his coming may find us rejoicing in his presence and welcoming the light of this truth. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord. Amen.
Thank you. thin, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin. Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. To the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Mistakes. Come today, there's a reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Tell the world of the truth. treasure you found.
Our first lesson comes from Psalm 116, 5 through 7. The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The Lord protects the unwary. When I was brought low, he saved me. Return to your rest, my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Heavenly Father, help us this day to listen. May we wait patiently to hear your still small voice, calling us deeper into you. Give us attentive ears that begin to separate the noise from the sounds of this world. Help us this day to hear you anew. Equip and empower us for what you call us for the service of this day. Lord, we lift up our spoken prayers for Chaz, Kathleen, Samantha, Greer, Ron, Wita, Jack, Alan, Lorraine, Dylan, John, Paul, Joan, Phyllis, Esther, Trey, Pat, Bobby, Winnie, Ella, Kyle, Will, Sue, Sharon, Christine, Ashley, Lori, Jerry, Linda, Rose, Eleanor, Bob, Sherry, Larry, Gloria, and Ben. Lord, you know what they need. Lord, hear our prayers. At this time, Lord, we bring our unspoken prayers to you. Lord, hear our prayers. We pray for our nation. May you heal our land. Lord, we continue to pray for an end to this virus, that you will heal the world in its grips. We continue to pray for those who are currently battling this virus and other illnesses. May you bring them comfort and lift their spirits. We ask that you strengthen and heal them, Lord. We pray for our first responders, medical workers, essential workers, and support staff. We also pray for our military, and we place a hedge of protection around them and their families. Lord, we pray for Chiques Church and the many churches in our local community and throughout the world. May your light shine through the church. Lord, we praise you and thank you for all that you have done, and ask of these things in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you for your generosity and faithful giving. We are blessed because of you to continue to support our missionaries and local communities. Let us recognize our Lord and Savior with joy in our hearts. As the Lord speaks to your heart today, we ask that you prayerfully consider giving of your gifts, tithes, and offerings, so that we're able to continue to be the hands and feet of Christ in our community, nation, and around the world. Now, your gifts can be mailed or given via our giving page on our church website at www.chickiesumchurch.com.
Thank you.
Lord, we pray that you bless these gifts. Bless the giver as well. Use these gifts in a bold and mighty way to continue to grow your kingdom. Lord, we lift them up before thee. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Have you ever flown in an airplane before? Do you wonder what happens before you get to the gate and board the plane? The most important thing that happens before a flight is the pre-flight check. A pre-flight check is exactly what it sounds like it would be. A checklist that the pilot, and sometimes the co-pilot, go over before each and every flight. Sounds easy, right? Not so fast. This check is an all-encompassing evaluation of the airplane and is a critical safety-related check that is actually required by many FAA regulations. For safety reasons, it's important that before this big task, the pilot not be interrupted during the pre-flight check so as not to miss anything. The pilot needs time free of distractions. So, what do they check? Well, first thing is a self-assessment to see if the pilot and if there's a co-pilot are fit to fly. So, this happens before the pilot even gets to the aircraft. After the pilot or pilots determine that they are fit to fly, they approach the aircraft and start pre-flighting the aircraft. Now, as they walk up to the aircraft, they begin by looking for, well, obvious discrepancies, such as, are both wings attached to the aircraft? Check. Do you see any flat tires? No. Good. Check. Is there a crack running down the fuselage? No. Good. Check. After they get to, well, the aircraft, and they go inside the cockpit, they will follow a checklist, typically called the pre-flight checklist. Now, this is very specific to the make and model of that aircraft. The checklist will direct them on their pre-flight as they do their checks. So the pilot starts in the cockpit, checking to ensure all the paperwork is in order, checking the aircraft logbooks, then checking the switches and dials are all set properly, and making sure the pilot has the proper equipment for their flight. As long as nothing has been found to be out of compliance, they move on to check the outside of the aircraft. Starting on, the left side of the aircraft, they will start to make, a circle around the aircraft as they check everything, from the cockpit to the tail of the aircraft, to the right wing, to the nose of the airplane, to the left wing, and then finally back inside the cockpit. As they do their walk around the airplane, they are looking for, any dents or scratches, ensuring the flight controls move freely and correctly. Checking fuel and oil levels, looking for any leaks, and depending on the weather, making sure there's no snow or frost or ice adhering to the aircraft. Now, this might seem like a lot to check, but if you have ever driven a car after someone else, it is easy to see, controls change. Mirrors, seats needing to be readjusted, radio station or volumes, and fuel levels on empty at times. So after completion of the pilot's walk around, it's time for the pilot to make note of, if there was any discrepancies found during their pre-flight check and make an important decision. Is the aircraft legal to fly right now. And number two, is it safe to fly? As long as the pilot determines the aircraft to be legal and safe, they're cleared to go flying. Piloting an airplane is a big job, worthy of experts in the field. Wouldn't you agree? I am so glad they take the time to avoid distractions and practice inward silence as they get ready to take their passengers safely to their next destination. So when faced with the safety of the pilot and those on board, the pilot puts in action, well, the spiritual discipline of an inward silence. Now this empowers the pilot to do the pre-flight check without distractions, so they are cleared to fly safely. So my question to you is this: what spiritual disciplines do you use when faced with a big job or significant task that empowers you for the work ahead? Will you join with me in prayer? Gracious and Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. We ask that you open our minds and our hearts to your word, and may you receive the honor, glory, and praise in all that we do. I pray this now in Jesus' precious name. Amen. This is our third week in our four-week series titled Airplane Mode, Practicing Spiritual Disciplines. We live in a noisy world. Even when alone, apart from sound, we're bombarded with newspaper headlines, texts, emails, and social media messages. The desire to seek solitude and silence isn't only about finding a quiet place. It's about discovering the gift of removing ourselves from the abundance of messages to find our rest in the Word, Jesus. A time of silence and solitude in God's presence can heal us of the past and prepare us for our futures. Now this week, we are going to look at more spiritual disciplines that can equip and empower us for the work ahead. Now here's a great example found in our gospel lesson today in the book of Mark, chapter 1, verses 35 to 38. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The context of this passage is important to know. Why did Jesus go away to a solitary place to pray? The Gospel of Mark begins with little prelude. Jesus gets right to work, calling his first disciples and stopping in the synagogue in Capernaum to teach. As he initiates his, public ministry of preaching, though, he pauses to spend time alone with God. So what matters is that he withdraws from people and he prays. Now this episode, coming so early in the Gospel of Mark, highlights the importance of time apart in silence and in prayer throughout Jesus' ministry. In the book, Life Together by Dietrich Bonhoeffer, articulates the necessity of time with others and time apart. He says, "Blessed is he who is alone in the strength of fellowship, and blessed is he who keeps the fellowship in the strength of aloneness." Our solitude empowers us to speak back into community as Jesus does when he reemerges and begins his preaching ministry. Now, Bonhoeffer also says, the mark of solitude is silence, as speech is the mark of community. Silence and speech have the same inner correspondence and difference as do solitude and community. One does not exist without the other. Right speech comes out of silence, and right silence comes out of speech. So, as we begin to explore the spiritual discipline of silence, it is important to grasp from the very start the truth that we are given a conversational relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, if Jesus thought it was important to pause and spend, time alone with God before beginning a big task, then it should be something we should do as well. Jesus wants to speak to us. He will speak to us, and we can learn to, recognize his voice. This is why silence becomes so crucial. Listening is very important to the spiritual discipline of silence. We must, pay attention. We must want to hear. If we want to learn the value of silence, how to recognize God's voice, and how to, distinguish God's voice from, say, the voices of others, we can begin by asking God to teach us about this. It's important for us to persist with this discipline, especially if our minds are racing. It often takes a while for our minds to quiet down. So our challenge today is, will we, when faced with a big job or task, spend time alone in silence and prayer before the work ahead? Our biblical story is about the Apostle Paul's conversion. The story of Paul's conversion on the road to Damascus is told in the book of Acts, chapter 9, and retold by Paul in Acts, chapter 22, and Acts, chapter 26. Now, here's a little background leading up to the conversion of Paul. Saul of Tarsus, a Pharisee in Jerusalem, after the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ, swore to eliminate the new Christian church. Now, Acts chapter 9, verse 1 says that Paul was breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. Saul obtained, letters and direction from the Jewish high priest, authorizing him to arrest any followers of Jesus in the city of Damascus. So, on the road to Damascus, Saul and his companions were struck down by a blinding light. Acts chapter 9, verse 4 tells us, Saul heard a voice say this, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? And verse 5 and 6 tells us that when Saul asked who was speaking, the voice replied, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do. What would you do? I think for me, I'd listen. Now the scripture tells us that the bright light had blinded Saul, but not the rest of his companions. So what would they do? Well, his companions led him into Damascus to a man named Judas on Straight Street. The scripture tells us that for 3 days, Saul was blind and didn't eat or drink. This is a spiritual discipline of fasting for direction and guidance. Now, meanwhile, Jesus appeared in a vision to a disciple in Damascus named Ananias and told him to go to Saul. Sounds good so far, right? A disciple of Jesus receives a vision and everything is in place for this meeting. Not exactly. Remember, Saul was, well, persecuting disciples of Jesus. So Ananias was, well, he was filled with fear because he knew that Saul's reputation as a persecutor of the church. So scripture tells us that Jesus repeated his command, explaining that Saul was his, well, chosen instrument to deliver the gospel to the Gentiles, their kings, and the people of Israel. Have you ever had to repeat yourself or explain why you need something done? I believe when Jesus explained this to Ananias, there may have been a profound emphasis put on the why. So Ananias does what Jesus asked and finds Saul at Judas' house praying for help. Now remember, Jesus told Saul to go to the city and you will be told what you will do. It is at this point that Ananias arrives and lays his hands on Saul, telling him Jesus had sent him to restore his sight and that Saul might be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now the scripture, well, tells that something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. Well, now that he can see again, what would be the first thing he would do? Well, Paul arose and was baptized into the Christian faith. Then Paul ate, regained his strength, and stayed with the Damascus disciples for 3 days. Soon after his conversion, Saul changed his name to Paul. Now, immediately following Paul's conversion, he withdrew into the Arabian wilderness for a time. Now, this extended retreat was marked by, well, the spiritual disciplines of solitude and silence, in which Paul, well, meditated intensely on God's word and spent much time in prayer. While Paul was practicing these spiritual disciplines, he received his gospel message by revelation from Jesus Christ. See, this time away had equipped him for the lifetime of involvement and service to his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. What about you? What are some big tasks you're facing right now? How are you preparing for them? In the past, when facing a big task, what have been, well, some of the most helpful ways you've prepared? Has prayer been part of your preparation? Have you taken the extra step of seeking silence and solitude before a big task? Why or why not? As you look ahead at the big task you are now facing, how might you, well, incorporate silence and solitude into your preparation? How hard is it for you to be quiet in God's presence? Let us remember that the spiritual discipline of silence, when faced with a big job or task, time spent alone in silence and prayer will equip and empower us for the work ahead. Being able to take time apart in silence and prayer can help us hear God's still small voice. Remember, Jesus sought silence and solitude to be in the presence of God before his big task. He wanted time to be silent and to hear God's still small voice, who gives, well, it gives us guidance, comfort, strength, mercy, and grace. See, Jesus listened and was obedient to God's will, and so can we. Remember, the Apostle Paul experienced a time of silence and solitude and God's presence, which healed him from blindness and prepared him for his future. He put spiritual disciplines in action. Following God's will is not easy at all. The Apostle Paul's life-changing experience on the Damascus Road led to his baptism and instruction in the Christian faith. Now, the scriptures testify that the Apostle Paul had suffered many hardships, but revealed how he endured those hardships for the gospel. He wrote in Philippians 4:13, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Like all of us, the Apostle Paul was human and vulnerable to failure whenever he took his eyes off Jesus Christ. In order to guard against failure, Paul employed many of the spiritual disciplines. These practices, such as silence and solitude, prayer and service, strengthened him in his walk with God and reminded Paul of his dependence on God. Now, what are some ways that we can apply the spiritual discipline of silence in our lives? Now, here are just a few. Find a space of physical silence where you can, sit quietly, away from, distracting demands, voices, and sounds. Don't try to fill it with words. Instead, just sit in the silence and open your heart and mind to God. Now, if you're driving in your vehicle, maybe turn off the car radio and drive in silence. Seek rest for your body, mind, and soul while you're spending time in solitude and silence. Take deep breaths and let the peace of God's presence fill your body. Receive God's guidance. Maybe it's getting up early in the morning before the rest of your house awakes, and spend that quiet early morning time with God. For me, I have a cup of coffee and just sit in silence, listening for God's still small voice. The more time you spend with God and solitude and silence, the more you'll learn how to recognize God's voice when he speaks to you. So when faced with a big job or task, let's spend time alone in silence and prayer before the work ahead. This and other spiritual disciplines will lead us to, greater trust in God's will. Will you join with me now in prayer? Lord, your word says we can bring our problems to you in prayer, and that your peace will guard our hearts and minds. Lord, we try to stay focused on you, especially when we pray. But sometimes the noise of this world is just too loud. Help us, Lord, to focus our hearts and minds on you. Help us to hear your still small voice. Amen. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion, fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Our service is over. His service begins. Take care and God bless.